Welcome to Door County Drone. Today's video is how the LNG tanks are brought from ship to shore. The BBC Son is offloaded by assistance of the tug's Chaz Asher and David R. Shannock of Rhone Salvage and some help of the bay ship tug. A typical LNG carrier has 4 to 6 tanks located along the centerline of the vessel. Surrounding the tanks is a combination of ballast tanks, cofferdams and voids. In effect, this gives the vessel a double hull type design. Inside each tank there are typically 3 submerged pumps. There are 2 main cargo pumps which are used in cargo discharge operations and a much smaller pump which is referred to as the spray pump. The spray pump is used for either pumping out liquid LNG to be used as fuel via a vaporizer or for cooling down cargo tanks. It can also be used for stripping out the last of the cargo in discharge operations. All of these pumps are contained within what is known as the pump tower, which hangs from the top of the tank and runs the entire depth of the tank. The pump tower also contains the tank gauging system and the tank filling line, all of which are located near the bottom of the tank. In membrane-type vessels there is also an empty pipe with a spring-loaded foot valve that can be opened by weight or pressure. This is the emergency pump tower. In the event both main cargo pumps fail, the top can be removed from this pipe and an emergency cargo pump lowered down to the bottom of the pipe. The top is replaced on the column and then the pump is allowed to push down on the foot valve and open it. The cargo can then be pumped out. All cargo pumps discharge into a common pipe which runs along the deck of the vessel. It branches off to either side of the vessel to the cargo manifolds, which are used for loading or discharging. All cargo tank vapor spaces are linked via a vapor header which runs parallel to the cargo header. This also has connections to the sides of the ship next to the loading and discharging manifolds. A typical cargo cycle starts with the tanks in a gas-free condition, meaning the tanks are full of air, which allows maintenance on the tank and pumps. Cargo cannot be loaded directly into the tank, as the presence of oxygen would create an explosive atmospheric condition within the tank, and the rapid temperature change caused by loading LNG at -162 degrees Celsius, -260 degrees Fahrenheit, could damage the tanks. First, the tank must be inert to eliminate the risk of explosion. An inert gas plant burns diesel and air to produce a mixture of gases, typically less than 5% O2 and about 13% CO2 plus N2. This is blown into the tanks until the oxygen level is below 4%. Next, the vessel goes into port to gas up and cool down. As one still cannot load directly into the tank, the CO2 will freeze and damage the pumps and the cold shock could damage the tank's pump column. LNG is brought onto the vessel and taken along the spray line to the main vaporizer, which boils off the liquid into gas. This is then warmed up to roughly 20 degrees Celsius, 68 degrees Fahrenheit, in the gas heaters and then blown into the tanks to displace the inert gas. This continues until all the CO2 is removed from the tanks. Initially, the IG, inert gas, is vented to atmosphere. Once the hydrocarbon content reaches 5%, lower flammability range of methane, the inert gas is redirected to shore via a pipeline and manifold connection by the HD, high-duty, compressors. The shore terminal then burns this vapor to avoid the dangers of having large amounts of hydrocarbons present which may explode. Now the vessel is gassed up and warm. The tanks are still at ambient temperature and are full of methane. The next stage is cool down. LNG is sprayed into the tanks via spray heads, which vaporizes and starts to cool the tank. The excess gas is again blown ashore to be reliquefied or burned at a flare stack. Once the tanks reach about -140 degrees Celsius, -220 degrees Fahrenheit, the tanks are ready to bulk load. Bulk loading starts and liquid LNG is pumped from the storage tanks ashore into the vessel tanks. Displaced gas is blown ashore by the HD compressors. Loading continues until typically 98.5% full is reached, to allow for thermal expansion / contraction of cargo. The vessel can now proceed to the discharge port. During passage, various boil-off management strategies can be used. Boil-off gas can be burned in boilers to provide propulsion, or it can be reliquefied and returned to the cargo tanks, depending on the design of the vessel. Once in the discharge port, the cargo is pumped ashore using the cargo pumps. As the tank empties, the vapor space is filled by either gas from ashore or by vaporizing some cargo in the cargo vaporizer. Either the vessel can be pumped out as far as possible, with the last being pumped out with spray pumps, or some cargo can be retained on board as a heel. It is normal practice to keep on board 5% to 10% of the cargo after discharge in one tank. This is referred to as the heel, and this is used to cool down the remaining tanks that have no heel before loading. This must be done gradually, otherwise the tanks will be cold shocked if loaded directly into warm tanks. Cool down can take roughly 20 hours on a MOS vessel and 10 to 12 hours on a membrane type vessel, so carrying a heel allows cool down to be done before the vessel reaches port, giving a significant time saving. If all the cargo is pumped ashore, then on the ballast passage the tanks will warm up to ambient temperature, returning the vessel to a gassed up and warm state. The vessel can then be cooled again for loading. If the vessel is to return to a gas-free state, the tanks must be warmed up by using the gas heaters to circulate warm gas. Once the tanks are warmed up, the inert gas plant is used to remove the methane from the tanks. Once the tanks are methane-free, the inert gas plant is switched to dry air production, which is used to remove all the inert gas from the tanks until they have a safe working atmosphere. We hope you enjoyed. Thank you for watching. Please like and subscribe.